Comp 1010 at the University of Manitoba, and I'm Dr. Celine LaTulip. And today I'm going to be showing you some stuff about comments and syntax parameters and dealing with errors in processing. All right, so let's get started. So here's a processing script, and this is pretty hard to comprehend. It's just a bunch of stuff, line after line. And so this is not what we would call very human readable. You can read through it, but it's really hard at a glance to tell what this program is for and what it's doing. So typically we want to add comments to help make programs human readable. And comments are completely ignored by the processing compiler and the Java compiler. So here's a basic comment. You put two slashes and then anything you write on the rest of the line will be ignored. So we want a slightly bigger canvas than the default. And that's why we've got size 500, 500, and let's have a white background. So that's a little bit wordy, but we could also put this at the end of the line like this, cut that and paste it here, and just say white background. So that helps us know why this line of code is there. So you can put comments in before a line, at the end of a line. You just, if I put a comment right here and I say this fill is for pink, and we say pink, this won't be executed. So you can't put it at the beginning of the line because then the computer would ignore this too. So we don't want to do that. So we can do this though, and that's fine. All right, so we can put these comments and we can also put blank lines to sort of break up our code. So maybe this is the setup stuff, setting the size and the background color, and then these lines, fill and rect, that draws a pink rectangle. So maybe what we want to do is put some comments like this, pink rectangle. And these four lines down, or these three lines down here, these draw a, I think a purple line. So let's see, purple line from top left to bottom right. And then this draws a green oval. Okay. So you can see that these comments, these are human words, they're going to be ignored by the computer, but they already, this program looks better. It's broken up into parts, you get descriptions of what each bit of the line of code are doing, and so that's very helpful. So that's one form of commenting with the two slashes. There's another form of commenting, and that is a multi-line comment, and the way we do that is with a slash star, and then a star slash, and everything in between these two is going to be ignored. So a really common practice is to put a multi-line comment at the top of your program that says what the program's for, who created it, when it was created, etc. So I'm going to say demo program for comp 1010, and it was created by Celine LaTulip, and it was created on August 23rd, 2019. Okay, so the computer will ignore everything in here. You can also use these comments that define the start and the end because it's kind of like an open bracket and a close bracket. You can use those in the middle of a line. So for example, here for this line, we might want to put one of these comments right in the middle of the code like this. So slash star top left corner to say what those first two things were, and then slash star bottom right corner like that. So unlike the slash slash, which basically means nothing else on the line is going to be read by the computer, this can actually go right in the middle of a line of code, and the computer will still read this stuff and try to do something with it. It will still read this and try to do something with that. So it's okay to put this form of commenting in the middle of a line of code. All right, so that's commenting, and these can be really helpful to make your computer program easier for people to understand. So generally, you want to put some comments above each section of code to describe what that section of code is doing. You want a general comment at the top of the program that describes who wrote the code and what it was for. And then you want comments anywhere where you think something might be hard to understand. You put comments in to help make that easier to understand. Okay, so syntax problems can also come up in computing, and we want to make sure that we look after and get the syntax right. So syntax is the way that statements are written so that computers can understand them. And so a statement in a processing program consists of some kind of command identifier like this, an opening bracket or parentheses like this, and then maybe some information separated by commas, a closing parentheses, and a semicolon. And so you'll see that that is pretty consistent here. We have different types of command identifiers, size and background and fill and rect, but all of them then have the opening parentheses, and then they have some information, and then they have a closing parentheses and the semicolon. There is one down here, maybe, oh no, there isn't, okay. So we could actually here in front of the pink rectangle, you can also have command statements that don't have any information inside the parentheses. So we could have a no stroke, and that doesn't have anything inside the parentheses, and that's okay. And that says don't use an outline for this pink rectangle. So let's run this program just to see what it looks like. Okay, so here we have it. We have a pink rectangle that doesn't have the black outline. We've got this line that goes from top left to bottom right that's sort of purple. And we've got this green oval in the middle that has a black outline. Okay, so one of the things to also pay attention to is that processing offers you syntax highlighting. And what we mean by that is it helps by showing you that it understands the syntax by coloring things specific colors. So all of the command identifiers, size, background, no stroke, fill, etc., all of these are colored in blue. And if you typed one of them wrong, so if I did that, you see that the color is gone because now processing no longer identifies that as a command. And you also, of course, get errors down here. So it says the function struke does not exist. It says, I don't know this command because there's a typo and you haven't spelled it correctly, okay? Remember that processing is actually case sensitive. So also if I change this stroke to a capital S stroke, again, it's no longer highlighted blue because processing doesn't recognize it as a valid command. And we get this feedback down here saying it doesn't exist. So remember that everything in processing is case sensitive. You've got to type it exactly right. So other things are things like these keywords. These are reserved special words in processing. So width and height, which are special words defining the width and height of the canvas. You can't use those for anything else. And these words are recognized by processing as special words. And so they're shown in pink. And note that our comments are shown in sort of this gray color text, not black. So processing helps you by doing this highlighting, syntax highlighting thing. And that's really great. Other common mistakes that you might make in terms of not getting the syntax right is you might forget a comma. So in this ellipse down here, if I forget this comma right here, then we have this error coming up. The function ellipse expects parameters like, and it's showing you that it's expecting float, comma, float, comma, float, comma, float. And floats are just a special kind of number, but it's basically saying, what I'm seeing here doesn't look like this, and it's because you've missed the comma. Okay, once I put the comma back, it's fine, right? If we forget a semicolon, that's also problematic, and processing will actually pretty easily recognize that and say, hey, you're missing a semicolon. Doesn't matter where we miss it, it will recognize that as an issue, okay? The parentheses also need to be there. So if you forget a parentheses, then the right parentheses processing will say, hey, I'm expecting to see a parentheses before we get to that semicolon, and it'll tell you that. That one's easy. What's actually a little bit harder is if you forget the parentheses at the front. And this is because here, processing is expecting to see a command identifier, and so it's reading rect 100 as a command identifier and saying, I don't know that command. It doesn't exist. So it doesn't say to you, you're missing the left parentheses. It tries to read that as a command, and it can't. So that one's a little bit harder to interpret. And so sometimes, depending on where the error is, it can be a little bit more difficult to figure out what's going on from the feedback that processing gives you down here. Okay, so I also want to talk to you about parameters. So all of these commands need to be given details. And the way we give details to commands is through these parameters, which is the pieces of information that are separated by commas inside the parentheses. And different jobs need different numbers and types of parameters. So to specify the size of the canvas, we need to say how wide and how tall it is. So it's got two number parameters, okay? Some commands don't need anything. So this one, no stroke, just says, I don't want you to use an outline around this shape. And you don't need to give it any details about that. You're just saying, don't use an outline. Okay, so this one has no parameters, this no stroke command. The rect command has four parameters because you've got to specify the top left coordinate, x, and the top left y coordinate. And then you've got to specify how wide and how tall the rectangle is. So in order for the processing to draw you a rectangle, it needs four details. It needs four pieces of information. Okay, so four parameters here. Some commands can take different numbers of parameters, and you've actually already seen that. So for example, the pink rectangle, to make it pink, we use the fill command that specifies the color, and we've given it three things, an R, G, and B, so red, green, and blue. We've given it three color details, which it combines to make pink. But down here, for the green oval, we gave it only one parameter, and this was a hexadecimal color number. So there's various versions of some commands that take different types and numbers of parameters. Okay, so we could also do a different kind of fill down here, and we could actually make the green oval semi-transparent by adding another parameter that was like 50, and that will make the green oval somewhat transparent. So here we have there. So that green oval, which used to be a darker green, now over that pink is looking barely green at all. Okay, but you can see now that it's transparent because we can see the line underneath it. So there are different types of the fill command that take different numbers of parameters. And so some, you have to just know that some commands will take different things, and you can look all of these up. There's a processing reference that tells you all of this. All right. So that's about all that we wanted to cover in talking about comments and syntax and parameters. The other thing to discuss, though, is errors. And so there are these errors that come up as you're typing. If you make a mistake like this, you forget the semicolon, this is called a compile time error. And it means the program won't run. Right now, with that error in place, I can't make the program run. It won't go. Okay? If I fix it, then the program will run. So compile time errors are usually kind of easy to fix because you get feedback that tells you where the problem is, right? So the other thing to note is if we try to run this, then sometimes we'll actually get errors down here, more information about that error, okay? So there are also execution time errors, and these are errors that happen that cause your program still to run, but not run properly. So for example, if we put a number in here that was like 100 divided by 0 as the x coordinate for our rectangle, well, divide by 0 is mathematically undefined. Now, this isn't causing a problem. It's not making a red error down here. It will compile, but when we try to run it, it actually won't be able to run. So it says arithmetic exception divide by 0. Okay, so that's trickier. And the other type of error is more of what we call a logic error that causes your program to run, but maybe not quite right. So let's look at this. If we put this green oval up here and we run our program, actually it can't go there, after the size in the background statement. So now all of a sudden our green oval has disappeared. And we might be like, well, wait a second. We've got code here for a green oval. We've got code for a pink rectangle and code for the purple line. But somehow it's not showing up. So why isn't it showing up? Where's the green oval gone? And so this is the type of logic error that's harder to fix because you're not getting any feedback. Processing doesn't know that there's a problem. This is a problem with your own program design. So then you have to figure out, how am I going to figure out what the problem is? And one of the ways that you can actually try to start to do this is by commenting out lines of code. So maybe you think, oh, maybe it's this transparency value. Maybe that's the problem. If I comment that out and I just use the default fill, maybe my oval will show up. And so you can try that. Nope, that's not the problem. Okay. So maybe it's the pink rectangle. And so if I comment out the pink rectangle, let's see what happens. Huh, okay. So I commented out the pink rectangle and there's my transparent green oval. And maybe by doing that, that's when you figure out, oh, I've got a drawing ordering problem. I'm drawing the pink rectangle over top of the green oval and it's bigger than the green oval, so the green oval isn't showing up. So then I can move my green oval past the pink rectangle. And that will help me to see, there we go. Now I can see my green oval again. So that was a logic error. That was a mistake in designing the program and drawing the oval before the rectangle when I really wanted the oval to be drawn after the rectangle so that it would be visible. So those errors can be harder to figure out, but commenting out bits and pieces of code can help you figure out where the error is. All right, thanks a lot. Hope that helps and we'll see you next time.